It is 1958. A man named T. Jack Foster took a trip with his three sons, T. Jack Foster Jr., Richard Foster, and Robert Foster, to Northern California to see if there were any development projects worth pursuing. T. Jack Foster Sr. wanted to work on one last major project with his sons, and he found that in Brewer Island, which would soon become Foster City.
Brewer Island was a great big 2,400 acre piece of land surrounded by levees, and the inside the levees were under cultivation for hay. The land was mud to a depth of 60 to 90 feet, and the top part had dried out, but that didn't make that much difference because we had to consider the structural strength of the whole parcel. See, the important thing that we had to deal with here was draining the island. You know, rain falls on it, and where's it going to go? So we have to be able to drain the island so it doesn't flood. And so that was, we decided, what they needed, they said, was a holding basin to hold the rainwater, and then the pumps so they can pump it out. Well, the planners and engineers sat down and worked out the holding basis being the top 2 feet of the lagoon system. So that's why, and they still do it, you'll notice that in the wintertime they lower the lagoon about 2 feet, so there's the holding basin. In the summertime they don't need a holding basin because it's not going to rain, so they fill it up. Having decided that the lagoon it would be the holding basin, then the layout of the city kind of had to be sort of equidistant from the lagoon. That's why the lagoon's a big curve like that. And then so all the parcels of land could be not exceed a certain distance.
With the drainage system set in place, T. Jack Foster could begin filling in the rest of the island using hydraulic sand from San Bruno Shoal. This ensured Foster City would not be susceptible to sinking and allowed development starting from the ground up. Land during the early stages of Foster City was not the most appealing, for it was mostly a dust bowl. However, some people saw the potential in Foster City. One person who saw the potential in Foster City was Wayne McFadden.
Well, I was an attorney representing districts, cities, and counties throughout the state. I don't know, when you go as an attorney throughout the communities, the counties, the cities, and the districts, and you see them over a period of years, you see how they develop and you see how the impact on the people. If you have any compassion, you begin to realize how critical plans and master plans and balance are.
Foster City at the time was just a district, but Wayne wanted to change that for the betterment of the city. He and other citizens wanted more input on how the city was going to be developed.
Even though we were a district, we didn't have the power of a city for zoning critical, for trade-off, for parks, things like that. I wanted the city to become a city because we weren't. And we did go to legislation and got a right to vote.
That right to vote led to 74% of the residents signing in favor of Foster City being incorporated. And on April 27, 1971, Foster City officially became a city. Foster City established a new form of government where residents elected 5 members to serve on the city council. Out of those, whoever had the most votes was named mayor. It came to no surprise that Wayne McFadden was named the first mayor of Foster City. Like any new city, Foster City had some turbulent years. But thanks to civil leaders within the community learning and growing together, Foster City was able to stabilize and become the wonderful city it is today.